let us see tensile test on low carbon steel, which is also known as structural steel or mild steel. We know that we use universal testing machine in strength of materials laboratory to conduct the tensile test on MS or mild steel. The mechanical behavior of the materials has to be understood thoroughly. This would help in proper design of the structural elements. Generally, lab experiments are performed to understand how the materials behave when subject to loading. The usual procedure is: place small specimen of the material in a testing machine, apply the load and measure the resulting deformations, such as change in length or maybe change in diameter. This is the universal testing machine. The ends of the circular specimen are enlarged to fit in the grip. So this end and this end, they are enlarged to fit in the grips of the universal testing machine or jaws of the universal testing machine. So the failure will not occur near the grips themselves. Since the area is enlarged at the end, the failure will not occur at the end because of the more cross-sectional area. A failure at the ends would not produce the desired information about the material, because the stress distribution near the grips is not uniform, because as per the St. Venant's principle, which is very famous in strength of materials, we know that the stress distribution, though we take uniform throughout the cross section, but it is not uniform near the ends, because the load is applied near the ends and the stress distribution near the application of load is always greater than that which is away from the load, and therefore the stresses at the ends would tend to be more as compared to the stresses in the middle portion, and therefore the ends of this circular specimen is enlarged so that the failure occurs somewhere in the middle of the specimen. For properly designed specimen, failure occurs in the prismatic portion, that is within this L naught of the specimen, so that the stress distribution is uniform. Here the bar is subjected only to pure tension, there is no other structural action. The American Society for Testing and Materials standard says about tension specimen that the diameter is 0.505 inches, that is approximately 12.625 mm, that is this diameter here. The gauge length, that is this L naught, is 2 inches, that is approximately 50 mm between the gauge marks. Here there is one gauge mark, here there is one gauge mark. The gauge marks are nothing but points where extensometer arms are attached to the specimen. Here at this gauge mark and the lower gauge mark, the extensometer arms are attached to measure the extension. The specimen is pulled, the axial load is measured and it is recorded. It is either automatically or by reading from a dial. The elongation over the gauge length is measured simultaneously. It's done either by mechanical gauges or by electrical resistance strain gauges. This is a static test where the load is applied gradually. So, precise rate of loading is not of our interest. This is because the rate of loading doesn't affect the behavior of the specimen. However, in a dynamic test, load is applied very rapidly and sometimes in a cyclical manner, and therefore the nature of a dynamic load definitely affects the properties of the material being tested. So the rate of loading must be measured and must be specified. Now let us talk about stress strain diagram. The test results depend upon the dimensions of the specimen, the structural elements will not have the same size as that of the test specimen, and therefore test results should be expressed in such a form so that it can be applied to members of any size. So convert the test results to stresses and strains. There is a simplest way. We know that axial stress sigma is axial load P divided by cross section area A of the specimen. We also know that average axial strain epsilon A is equal to change in length divided by the gauge length. After performing a tension test and determining the stress and strain at various magnitudes of the load, a diagram of stress versus strain can be drawn. This diagram is a characteristic of the particular material being tested. It clearly conveys the important information about the mechanical properties and type of behavior of that material. Now, let us see stress-strain behavior of structural steel, which is known as low carbon steel or mild steel. Structural steel is one of the most widely used metals in engineering applications. It is found in buildings, bridges, cranes, ships, towers, vehicles, and many other types of construction. From figure we can see a typical stress strain diagram for a structural steel in tension. Strains are plotted on the horizontal axis, that is x-axis. This axis is a strain, epsilon A. Whereas stresses, that is sigma, are plotted on the vertical axis. The diagram begins with a straight line from origin O to point A. This shows that relationship between stress and strain in this initial region is not only linear but also proportional. Beyond point A, proportionality between stress and strain no longer exists. That is, as we go beyond point A, the proportionality between stress and strain ceases to exist. So the stress at A is called as proportional limit. Important notes: two variables are said to be proportional if their ratio remains constant. Here the two variables are stress sigma and strain epsilon A. Therefore, a proportional relationship may be represented by a straight line through the origin. However, a proportional relationship is not the same as a linear relationship. A proportional relationship is linear, but the linear relationship may not be necessarily proportional. A relationship represented by a straight line that doesn't pass through the origin is linear, but it is not proportional. For low carbon steels, the proportional limit is observed to be between 210 to 350 megapascal or newton per mm square. For high strength steels with higher carbon content plus some other alloys added in it, the proportional limits are observed to be more than 550 newton per mm square. The slope of the straight line from O to A, if we see the graph, from O to A, it is straight line, is nothing but stress by strain. If we take the slope of this straight line from O to A, that is this dy by dx, then it is stress by strain, which is defined as Young's modulus of elasticity E. We know that strain is a unitless quantity, and therefore Young's modulus has the same units as stress. Again, the increase in stress beyond proportional limit makes the strain to begin to increase more rapidly for each increment in stress. Consequently, the stress-strain curve has a smaller and smaller slope beyond point A. Beginning at this point, considerable elongation of the test specimen occurs with no noticeable increase in the tensile force, that is from B to C, you can clearly see that the tensile force is not increasing because the stress is almost constant, but the strain is increasing, and this region is called as perfect plasticity or yielding, whereas the initial region OA is called as linear region. This phenomena is known as yielding of the material. Here B is a yield point and the corresponding stress in the material is called as yield stress or yield strength of the steel. Now if we exaggerate the figure, or if we look the stress strain curve closely, here this was point A and this was point B, that is A was proportional limit and B was the yield point. Now if we closely have a look, then we will come to know that after B the curve suddenly dips. So after increasing steadily, the load suddenly drops to a slightly lower value. It is maintained for a certain period in the test. However, the specimen keeps elongating. In a very carefully conducted test, it is possible to distinguish between upper yield point and lower yield point. So here it is upper yield point and here it is lower yield point. Upper yield point corresponds to the load which is reached just before yield starts, whereas lower yield point corresponds to the load required to maintain that yield. Upper yield point is always transient in nature, and therefore lower yield point should be always used to determine the yield strength of the material. In the region from B to C, material becomes perfectly plastic. It deforms without an increase in the applied load. It is observed that elongation of a mild steel specimen in perfectly plastic region is about 10 to 15 times the elongation of the same specimen in the linear region. After undergoing the large strains that occur during yielding in the region BC, the steel begins to strain harden. So after C, the material starts to strain harden. During strain hardening phenomena, the material undergoes changes in its crystalline structure, and therefore this results into increased resistance of the material to further deformation. Elongation of the test specimen in this region requires an increase in the tensile load, and therefore the stress strain diagram has a positive slope from C to D. That means again the load carrying capacity of tensile specimen goes on increasing because of the increased resistance of the material, which in turn is due to changes in the crystalline structure. The load eventually reaches its maximum value at D, and the corresponding stress at D is called the ultimate stress or ultimate strength of the material. Further stretching of the bar is actually accompanied by the reduction in the load, and finally the fracture occurs at point E. So this portion DE shows that after the ultimate load is reached, the load decreases with the further increase in the strain, and this portion is called as necking, and finally the specimen fractures or breaks at E, where the test ends. When a test specimen is stretched, the lateral contraction occurs. Here it can be clearly seen that the diameter has reduced. Resulting decrease in cross-sectional area is too small to have a noticeable effect on the calculated values of the stress or stresses up to about point C. But beyond that point C, the reduction in area begins to alter the shape of the curve. In the vicinity of the ultimate stress, that is near to point D, the reduction in area of the bar becomes clearly visible. That means when the test reaches to a point where we get the ultimate load or ultimate stress, then we can clearly see the neck formation or the reduction in the cross-sectional area of the specimen. A pronounced necking of the bar can be seen. Rupture or the breaking occurs along a comb-shaped surface. So if we see here, this or this, it is a comb-shaped surface. This surface forms an angle of 45 degrees approximately with the original surface of the specimen. This clearly indicates that shear is primarily responsible for the failure of the ductile materials. It confirms the fact that under an axial load, shearing stresses are largest on surfaces forming an angle of 45 degrees with the load. Now here, it is called as cone. Sorry, this is called as cone and this is called as cup. So it is cup and cone. Now we can see percent elongation. It is given by L1 minus L0 divided by L0 into 100, where L0 is original gauge length, that is the distance between two gauge marks, which is taken as 50 mm by ASTM, and L1 is nothing but the distance between the gauge marks after fracture. That means again, when we keep this specimen attached to each other and then we measure the distance between this gauge mark and this gauge mark, definitely that L1 will be more than L0 because the material has stretched itself because of the tensile axial load applied. Elongation is not uniform over the length of the specimen. It is very important to note here that the elongation is concentrated in the region of necking only, and therefore the percentage elongation depends upon the gauge length. So when we state the percent elongation, we must state the gauge length which is used for testing. For a 50 mm gauge length, it is observed that steel may have an elongation in the range from 3% to 40% depending upon the composition of that steel. For structural steel, the values may be between 20% to 30%. Percent reduction in area can also be calculated. It is A0 minus A1 divided by A0 into 100. A0 is original cross-sectional area, that is the diameter of the bar as per ASTM 12.625 mm, that is 0.505 inches. And A1 is the final cross-section area at fracture section. For example, if we see here the minimum area at the section where the my steel is fractured or it has broken, then you can see that it is less than original cross-section area, and that is taken as A1. For ductile steel, the reduction is about 50%. More percentage of elongation and more percentage of reduction in area indicates that the material is more ductile. Now, if the actual cross-sectional area at the narrow part of the neck is used to calculate the stress, it results in the true stress strain curve. It gives line CE dash. So instead of CDE, it comes as OABCDE dash, or you can say CE dash rather. D point will not come. The total load the bar can carry indeed diminishes after the ultimate stress is reached, as shown by curve DE. But this reduction is due to the decrease in area of the bar, and it is not due to a loss in strength of the material itself. In reality, the material withstands an increase in true stress up to failure point E. The conventional stress strain curve OABCDE, that is this OABCDE, is based upon the original cross-sectional area. We know that as the test progresses, the diameter of the bar goes on reducing and the original diameter becomes less at the spot where the necking is occurring, but still we calculate or we draw rather the conventional stress strain curve, which is based upon the original cross-sectional area only. That is, we take original diameter, we don't use the reduced diameter in the calculation. but most structures are expected to function at stresses which are much below the proportional limit, and therefore the conventional stress strain curve provides satisfactory information for use in engineering design. The figure shows that proportions are not realistic, that is not drawn to scale. The strain that occurs from B to C may be greater than 10 times the strain occurring from O to A. Strains from C to E, that is this portion, are many times greater than the strains from B to C. The correct relations are portrayed in figure because this is drawn to scale. The strain is drawn to scale. Strains from 0 point to point A are much lesser than strains from point A to point E. So they cannot be seen. Hence, the initial part of the diagram appears to be vertical line. Presence of a clearly defined yield point followed by large plastic strains are important characteristic of structural steel. That means the structural steel has two distinct properties. One is presence of a clearly defined yield point, which is followed by large plastic strains. This is sometimes utilized in practical design by engineers. Metals such as structural steel undergo large permanent strains before failure. Hence, they are classified as ductile. A desirable feature of ductile material is nothing but visible distortions occur if the loads become very large. This provides an opportunity to take remedial action before an actual fracture occurs, because the failure will be ductile instead of brittle in case of mild steel, and therefore it will not be sudden. It will take its own time to fail, and therefore the remedial action can be taken before the actual fracture occurs. Also, materials exhibiting ductile behavior are capable of absorbing large amounts of strain energy prior to fracture. For this, I have referred Mechanics of Materials book by James M. Gear and Mechanics of Materials book by F. V. Beer and Johnston. Thank you very much.